Welcome you all. Today we are going to discuss scale-up and post-approval changes for the modified relief dosage form. Learning objectives. Students should be able to understand about SUPAC MR guidelines, that is modified release dosage form, then definition, scientific rationale of this guideline, level of change, component and composition, manufacturing site change, then batch size change, it is also known as scale-up, manufacturing change in terms of process and equipment, and limitation of SUPAC MR guideline, that is modified release guideline. Now, what exactly SUPAC? In a process of developing a new drug product, the batch size used in the earliest human studies are small. The size of batches are gradually increased is known as scale-up, and the scale-up process and the changes made after approval in composition, then manufacturing process, then manufacturing equipment, then change of site have to become known as scale-up and post-approval changes. Means after approval of your NDA or ANDA application, if you want to make a change either in component composition or manufacturing process or equipment or manufacturing site, then that change you have to make as per this SUPAC guideline. Scientific and rationale of this guideline: to expedite the process of post-approval change of drug product, means a post-approval change is speed up because of this guideline. FDA can assure their safety and effectiveness after change and lower the regulatory burden for the industry. In case of different changes, we are following guideline, that's why it does not affect quality and performance of your formulation, and simultaneously it decreases the regulatory burden of industry. FDA has issued various guidance for the SUPAC changes, designated as SUPAC IR for the immediate release, solid orals, SUPAC MR for the modified release solid orals, and SUPAC SS for non-sterile semi-solid dosage form. For all these three type of the dosage form, SUPAC guidelines are given by FDA. And today we are going to discuss about SUPAC MR guidelines. Now this SUPAC defines different levels, that is minor, moderate and major level of your change. Then tests, compendial tests are there, then in vitro dissolution release tests are there, and in vivo bioequivalence study you have to perform for this particular type of change. And this, after completion of this change and test, you have to file that things into some documents, and that documents will be annual report, then changes being affected supplement, and prior approval supplement. Okay, now theme behind this guideline: if you want to make change, the change is categorized into three basic level, that is minor, moderate and major. After that change, you have to perform some test to cross check whether your change is affecting on quality and performance of your formulation, and for that purpose these three tests you have to perform. Again, after completion of your change and this test, you have to record these things into the files, and that files will be your annual report, changes being affected supplement, and prior approval supplement. Now, these guidelines provide recommendation for post-approval changes in component and composition, then manufacturing site, then batch size change, is also known as scale-up of manufacture, then manufacturing process and equipment. Now, dissolution testing. The dissolution testing is categorized into three cases. First is single point dissolution profile into compendial medium. In that case, you have to use 0.1 normal HCl as a medium, and your drug should be released 80% within 50 minutes in your 900 ml of HCl. Now, as per USP, apparatus 1, if you are using, then you have to set RPM 100. If you are using apparatus 2, then go with 50 RPM. Then case B, dissolution profile consists of multi-point dissolution profile. In this case B, you can use compendial medium. Compendial medium is which was given in your official book for your selected drug. Just you have to withdraw sample multiple points, that's why it is known as multi-point dissolution profile. Then your proposed and currently accepted formulation should have a same release profile. Then your case 3, multi-point dissolution profile in multiple medium. Okay, means you have to take a multiple medium, and in that multiple medium you have to take a multi-point dissolution profile. Then component and composition. This section focuses on changes in excipients of your drug product. CPAC MR guidelines classified excipients as a critical and non-critical to release point of view. Then changes in a non-release controlling excipients and changes in a release controlling excipients. For these two type of this excipients, separate guidelines are given. This is for your modified release non-release controlling parameters. The excipient which does not have effect or does not have a impact on release profile of your formulation, that are known as non-release controlling parameters. Now you can make these three level or three type of the changes in your non-release controlling parameter. Your level 1 change will be deletion or partial deletion of ingredient, and up to CPAC IR 1 level of excipient range. This excipient you can change as per your CPAC IR guideline or as per given into your CPAC IR guideline of FDA. Means concentration you can change same as that of your immediate release dosage form. Just you have to maintain a document separate for your modified release. Means I want to say that concentration of your excipient, say for example binder, then disintegrant, then filler, coming under your level 1 is same as that of your immediate release dosage form. Nothing is different. Then test document required to maintain, that is chemistry documentation, then compendial requirement release test, and you have to perform stability for your first manufacturing batch, that is long-term stability data. All these things you have to report into annual report. Then level 2 change in a technical grade of excipients, and up to CPAC IR level 2 excipient range you have to follow. Then stability application and compendial requirement tests. One batch with 3 months stability, that is accelerator stability study, reported into prior approval supplement. And long term stability study you have to perform for first production batch, and that things you have to report into annual report. Then dissolution profile you have to perform, that is multi-point dissolution profile into USP media, pH 4.5 to 7.5 for extended release, and three different medias are used for the delayed release, that is water, HCl and USP buffer. Then you have to file it into prior approval supplement and annual report. Then third level of change, in this level you can change your excipients higher than that of your level 1 and 2. Okay, in level 1 you can change up to less than or equal to 5% of excipient. In level 2, 5 to 10% excipient you can change, and in level 3, greater than 10% of your excipient you can change. Then for your level 3, stability data you have to maintain along with application or compendial requirement test, and again here you have to perform biostudy or in vivo in vitro correlation, and these things you have to report into prior approval supplement. Then SUPAC MR guideline for release controlling parameter, or you can say for the critical parameter which are having a significant impact on release profile of your drug. Level 1 change, less than or equal to 5% wet by wet of your release controlling excipient you can change in level 1. Then change is based on total release controlling excipient contained. No other changes are coming under your level 1. Then documentation, chemistry documentation, that is application and compendial requirement. Then stability, first production batch, long term stability study you have to perform. Then dissolution document, none beyond the application or compendial requirement, means no separate dissolution test is required, just you have to perform the test as per compendial requirement. Then again, no need to perform the bioequivalence study for level 1 change of your critical parameter. Then this thing you have to report into annual report, and your annual report is consists of all information including long term stability data. Then we'll come to level 2, change in a technical grade of excipients, it's coming under your level 2, and less than or equal to 10% wet by wet change based on total release controlling excipient contained, it's coming under level 2. Now test document, that is chemistry documentation, then stability documentation, compendial requirement tests are included in your chemistry documentation, then updated executed batch record you have to submit along with your documents. Then for the dissolution test you have to perform multi-point dissolution profile into USP buffer 4.5 to 7.5 for extended release, and for the delayed release you have to go with 0.1 normal HCl, USP buffer 4.5 to 6.8. Okay, in these different medium you have to perform multi-point dissolution profile. Then your drug should have a release profile as that of your proposed batch. Then these things you have to report into prior approval supplement and into annual report. Then level 3 change with your critical parameter, addition or deletion of release controlling excipient, then greater than those listed above for the level 2 change. Okay, in level 2 it is less than or equal to 10%. If you want to change more than this or more than this 10%, then this change is coming under your level 3. for level 3 change, you have to perform compendial product release requirement, then updated executed batch record you have to maintain. For the stability, you have to take 3 batches with 3 month accelerated stability study data you have to collect, and that you have to mention into prior approval supplement. Then for the long term stability, you have to take first 3 manufacturing batches, and for these 3 manufacturing batches you have to perform long term stability study, and that data you have to report into annual report. Then for the dissolution documentation, for the extended release you have to perform multi point dissolution. You have to take an interval of 1 hour, then withdraw sample after 1 hour, 2 hour, and then after you have to take a 2 hour interval after two, and withdraw sample as it is extended release dosage form. After 2 hour you have to take 2 hour thereafter until either 80% of your drug is released from your drug product. Then for the delayed release, you have to take a multi-point dissolution profile you can use different dissolution media for this delayed release formulation. An interval should be your 15, 30, 45, 60 and 120 minutes until either 80% of your drug is released from your dosage form. Then this level 3 change you have to maintain into prior approval supplements and annual report. Then manufacturing site changes, this change into the location of your manufacturing plant, actual manufacturing plant, then packing operation, analytical test laboratory. If you want to change site of any 3, then you have to follow this guideline. But in a site change does not include change into process and equipment, then in composition and components, because separate guidelines are given for these 2 or for these 3, process, equipment and components. Now your new manufacturing site should be with in line of cGMP guideline. In modified release solid oral dosage form, in case of site change there are also 3 levels. Level 1, single facility, common personnel and no other changes are there. Means just within that single facility you are doing minor changes, then it is coming under level 1. Then test document required for your level 1 change, that is compendial requirement release test you have to perform for the level 1 change. No need to go for the bio study. This level 1 change you have to report into annual report, or you have to file into annual report. Then level 2 change for site, same contiguous campus, common personnel and no other changes. Means just you are changing building of your manufacturing process within same campus, then this is coming under level 2. Then therapeutic range of drug, all drugs either it is narrow or non-narrow therapeutic range of your drug, both are coming under this level 2. Then for this level 2, identification and description of your site change and updated batch record you have to provide. Then notification of site change you have to give. Then stability study also you have to perform along with the compendial requirement. Then multi-point dissolution profile for 3 other media, water, HCl and buffer. You have to perform until you will get 80% relief from your dosage form. Then apply some statistical test. F2 is the dissolution release profile test, helpful to compare dissolution profile of two batches. Then no bio study is required for the level 2. Then this change you have to file into changes being affected supplement. Then level 3 change, different campuses and different personnel you are using for your manufacturing process. Then in level 3, notification of new site is required, updated batch is required. Then stability study you have to perform. Then application and compendial requirement, release tests you have to perform. And along with this, you have to perform bio study, whether your drug is having a bio equivalence with your previous batch or with your proposed batch or not. Or you have to perform in vivo in vitro correlation. And this test you have to record or file into prior approval supplement. Now basically difference between this level 1, 2 and 3. Level 1 consists of within single facility you are doing minor changes. Then level 2 you are just changing manufacturing site within the campus. You are changing building but within same campus. And your level 3, you are completely changing campus also and personnel also, which are working into your manufacturing process or into analytical laboratory. Then batch size change, that is scale-up. Change in the size of batch from pilot batch. Then your new batch size should be in line with your CGMP guideline. Again, no change into the standard operating procedures. Then formulation, manufacturing procedures and into equipment. Just you are increasing number of units per batch. All scale-up changes should be properly validated. Then minimum batch size for the trial or bio batch be at least 1 lakh dosage units. Then batch size changes for modified release dosage form, level 1 change. If your change is up to 10 times of your pilot batch, then it is coming under level 2. If it is more than the 10 times of your pilot batch, then it is coming under level 2 change. Then for level 1, updated batch record required. Then compendial requirement, release test you have to perform. Then stability test you have to perform. No need to perform bio study. And all these things you have to file into annual report. Then level 2 change. Level 2 change consists of changes in batch size beyond factor of 10 times of size of your pilot batch. And suppose you have a 100 units manufacturing per batch, or you are manufacturing 100 strips per batch of your tablet, then if you want to manufacture 2000, then it is more than 10 times of your pilot batch. Then this change is coming under level 2. Then updated batch record you have to maintain. Then you have to perform compendial requirement, release test and stability test you have to perform. Then for the SUPAC MR you have to perform multi-point dissolution profile in multiple media. And apply statistical F2 test for the comparing dissolution profile of your drug. Then no bio study is required for the level 2, and this level 2 change you have to file into annual report and changes being affected supplement. Manufacturing changes in terms of your equipment and manufacturing process. This manufacturing changes guideline are given separately for equipment and separate for the process. Then appropriate validation studies are conducted for equipment and process. Then equipment changes. Level 1, alternate equipments of same design and principle and automated equipments. These are the type of the changes. Means if you want to replace your previous equipment with new equipment, but this new equipment is having the same design and same principle, then this is coming under the level 1, and you are moving towards the non-automated to automated equipment, then again it is level 1 change. For this level 1, you have to maintain document of updated batch record, then stability data, then compendial requirement release test you have to perform, and these things you have to file into annual report. Then level 2 change to equipment of different design and operating principle. And suppose you are performing sterilization process and right now you are using hot air oven and it is dry heat sterilization, okay, then you want to change this sterilizer or hot air oven with autoclave. Now autoclave is having a different principle, that is steam sterilization, and hot air is having a different sterilization principle. Means you are directly changing principle of your equipment along with the design, then this change is coming under your level 2. For this change, updated batch record required, stability data required, then compendial test you have to perform, then in case of dissolution you have to perform multi-point dissolution profile in 3 other media. Means you can say multi-point dissolution profile in multiple media, and that multiple media will be 0.1 normal HCl, then USP buffer 4.5 and 6.8 until you will get 80% release of your dosage form. Then again you have to calculate F2 statistical test for comparing dissolution profile of your drug. No need to go for the bio study, and this level 2 change you have to report into prior approval supplement. Then changes in the manufacturing process of modified release dosage form. Processing changes affecting the non-release controlling excipient and release controlling excipients. Then adjustment of equipment operating conditions, mixing time, operating speed within approved application range. Within approved application range means you are changing your things, changing your process within application range. Suppose drying time is 10 to 15 minutes for your granules. This is your applicable or approved range, and you want to increase it up to 20 minutes, then it is out of your approved range or out of your application range. If you want to make it from 12 to 14, then it is within application range. But if you want to change beyond the 15 minute, then it is coming under level 2. Otherwise, within approved application range, it is coming under your level 1. For these change, you have to maintain updated batch record, compendial requirement test you have to perform. No need to go with the bio study, and this change you have to report into annual report. Then level 2 change. Now level 2 change is having a difference that beyond approved application range. And if you want to change any parameter related with your process beyond the approved range, then it is coming under your level 2, and for that purpose you have to record updated batch, then stability, then compendial requirement, and multi-point dissolution profile you have to perform for these 3 different medias. For example, in HCl, then USP buffer 4.5 to 6.8 until 80% of your drug release from your dosage form. Then again you have to perform statistical test, that is F2 test, and compare dissolution profile. Then no bio study is required, and this change is being affected, supplement you have to file. Then level 3 change for your process, change in type of process used from wet granulation to direct compression, means you are directly changing process, whole process. Instead of dry granulation, you are moving towards the direct compression. So this is bigger change in your process. For that purpose, you have to maintain updated batch record, then stability, compendial profile you have to maintain, and as it is level 3, so you have to perform bio study, and all these change you have to record into prior approval supplement. Using similarity factor F2, FDA has placed more emphasis on the dissolution profile comparison in area of your post approval changes. For that purpose, you have to calculate the value of F2. Among several methods investigated for dissolution profile, F2 is the simplest test to calculate the similarity of your dissolution profile. Formula for the calculation of this F2 is equal to 50 plus log of whole bracket 1 plus 1 upon n summation of t is equal to 1 into n. N is nothing but your time point, either it is 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 15 minutes, then RT minus TT, whole bracket raised to 2, and again this whole bracket raised to minus 0.5 into 100. This is formula for your F2 calculation, where RT and TT are cumulative percent dissolved at a selected n time points. This n time means nothing but time interval, and cumulative release means how much drug is released at 10th minute, at 20th minute, 20th minute for each batch. R is for the reference batch and T is for the test batch. When two profiles are identical, then F2 is equal to 100. And FDA has set a public standard for F2 value in between 50 to 100 to indicate similarity between two dissolution profiles. This F2 test or this similarity factor, it indicates average percentage of similarity between two dissolution profiles. Then accept there are two values, F1 values and F2 values. F1 values are between 0 to 15, while F2 values should be in between 50 to 100. Okay, if F1 value is greater than 15, then it is having a significant dissimilarity in your dissolution profile. If your F1 value is greater than 15, and F2 value should be in between 50 to 100, and if you have a value in between this 50 to 100, then your two batches are showing similarity into the release profile, and for that purpose we are calculating this similarity factor. F2 is similarity factor and F1 is the dissimilarity factor. Now next is in vivo bioequivalence study. This bioequivalence study are performed to determine bioavailability of your updated batch or of your modified batch, and this bioavailability should be similar with your previous batch, means your pre-change batch and post-change batch should have same bioavailability. Both batches should be bioequivalence with each other, and for that purpose you have to perform IVC or in vivo study you have to perform, and you have to show that both of the batches are showing same bioavailability. Then this SUPAC MR guidelines are also having some limitations, as these guidelines given into September 1997 for guidance of modified release dosage form, and does not discuss multiple changes other than these guided points or other than these specified points. Number of changes are missing in these guidelines. Then these guidelines are always used with reference to other things, say for example excipient handbooks. This is all about SUPAC guideline for modified release dosage form. Thank you.